Hey everyone, it's Chaz. Welcome back to the channel. Hope you're ready for some more LeetCode because in this video, we will... That was kind of impressive. Comment down below with the timestamp of when you think Lucky's going to finally knock this over. But as I was saying, in this video, we will be looking at LeetCode Problem 75, Sort Colors. All right, well, that was quick. So let's start by reading the problem. Given an array nums with n objects colored red, white, or blue, sort them in place. Do not make a copy of the array. Sort them in place so that objects of the same color are adjacent with the colors in the order red, white, and blue. And it says instead of using the words red, white, and blue, we're actually just going to use integers 0, 1, and 2 to represent the colors red, white, and blue, respectively. The problem works exactly the same, whether you use numbers or you use actual strings, red, white, and blue. The only real difference is eventually when we try to figure out if a value is equal to 0, 1, or 2, we just use equal signs, whereas with strings, we would have used dot equals. Otherwise, whether you solve it with integers or strings or floats, the solution is exactly the same. And then the last part of this is the most important part. It says you must solve this problem without using the library's sort function. So we are not allowed to use arrays.sort. Because honestly, if you could just use arrays.sort, this problem would be done in one line. In fact, I just said the whole solution. Arrays.sort, done. This problem is also known as the Dutch national flag problem. And it was formulated by a famous computer scientist by the name of Edsger Dijkstra. And if you've had conversations with me in the past about coding and computer science, you have probably heard me talk about this guy. And you're probably thinking, isn't that the Dijkstra's algorithm guy? Yes, it is. And there's a lot more to him than just Dijkstra's algorithm. I'd highly encourage you to read up on this guy because he is quite the character. He has a lot of really fun quotes. My favorite one that I found so far is this one here. Object-oriented programming is an exceptionally bad idea which could only have originated in California. I wholeheartedly agree. And I like this quote so much that I'm going to put it on the top of the screen for the rest of this video. So let's come up with a solution here that can be done efficiently. I'm going to start by creating three pointers, left, mid, and right. Left will be used to copy the red values, or the zeros in this case. Mid will be used to traverse the array. It's just going to read each value in the array and figure out what to do. And then the right pointer will be used to copy blue values, or the number 2. We're going to place the left and mid pointers at the start of the array and place the right pointer at the end of the array. So if we start with an array like this one here, we'll have the left pointer in red all the way on the left side of the array. The mid pointer will start off with the left pointer, and then my right pointer will be all the way on the right side of the array. Next, we are going to check the value at the mid pointer, and then we're going to go through some logic depending on what that pointer is currently pointing to. So for example, if the value is 0 or red, then we're going to swap the values at left and mid, and then we're going to increment left and mid. So if we see a 0, just swap it with the left pointer and then move both of those pointers. If the value we read is 2, then we should swap the values at mid and right and then decrement right, but don't touch mid. So I showed you red and blue first because those are the ones that kind of require the most work. If the value ends up being 1 or white, this is actually the easy one. All we do is increment mid. Nothing happens to the left pointer, nothing happens to the right pointer. All right, so I thought I would show this algorithm with some actual physical props this time. So I've got my little alphabet blocks, but I'm using the number side of the block. And I've got some pointers. I've got my left pointer, which is going to be red, and my right pointer, which is going to be blue. And I don't have any white ones of these little spinners, so I'm just going to use a yellow one to represent the middle pointer. And I'll put the left and middle pointers at the start of this array and the right pointer at the end. Now, of course, I have to shuffle these, so let me take care of that.
And oh, hello, Lucky. Oh, all right. I guess it's break time. All right. So, what do you do? What, you want to shuffle them too? All right. So Lucky says these two need to be switched. Hey, you can't move the pointer. Only Java can move the pointer. Okay, let's try that again. So I've got my array of values. My right pointer goes at the end, my left pointer and my middle pointer both go at the beginning. So I said we were going to read the values using the middle pointer, the yellow one. Whenever we see a 0, we're going to swap it with the red pointer or the left pointer. When we see a 2, we're going to swap it with the right pointer. And when we see a 1, we're just going to move ahead. So when we start off, the middle pointer sees a 1, so we just move the middle pointer. And Lucky is back. Let's do this again. So the middle pointer was reading a 1, so we're just going to move the middle pointer. Now the middle pointer sees a 0. We're going to swap it with the left pointer, so just swap these two. Now I want you to notice that whenever I move the left pointer, the yellow pointer always ends up moving with it. Because see how the yellow pointer is at a 1, so we have to move it over? That's going to always happen. And we're going to take advantage of that later when we code this by saving a step whenever we move the red pointer. So now the middle pointer sees a 2. We're going to swap it with the right pointer and then pull back the right pointer. The middle pointer is now seeing a 1, so we're going to move the middle pointer. It won't always be a 1 when we swap it with the right pointer, but this time it is, so we'll just move it over. Now the middle pointer sees a 2, so let's swap it with the right pointer. Just swap these two, and then pull back the right pointer. The middle pointer still sees a 2, so swap it again. And then pull back the right pointer. The middle pointer now sees a 0, so let's swap it with the left pointer. Swap these, move the left pointer, and notice again that whenever we move the left pointer, the very next thing that happens is always the middle pointer moving as well. So let's move that, and the middle pointer now reads another 1, so we'll move the middle pointer again, and what will happen is that these pointers will end up out of order. The middle pointer will be on the wrong side of the right pointer. And when that happens, our algorithm stops. And if you notice, all of my blocks are sorted. All right, you want to see it again? Let's shuffle these one more time. Okay, let's try it like this. My left and middle pointers go to the beginning, and my right pointer goes to the end. So the first thing that happens is my middle pointer sees a 1, so we just move the middle pointer. Now my middle pointer sees a 2. Let's swap it with the right pointer's value and pull back the right pointer. Middle pointer now sees a 0. Let's swap it with the left pointer's value. Just like that, we move the left pointer. And once again, we moved the left pointer and the very next step was to move the middle pointer. Now my middle pointer sees another 1. So move it over again. Now it sees a 0. Let's swap it with the left pointer, move the left pointer, and once again the middle pointer ends up also moving because it sees a 1. Now my middle pointer reads the number 2. Let's swap it with the right pointer and pull back the right pointer. My middle pointer now sees a 1. Let's move it over. My middle pointer sees a 2, so let's swap it with the right pointer, but they're both in the same place, so just swap it with itself. And then pull back the right pointer. And look what happens again. My middle pointer is on the wrong side of the right pointer. Our algorithm stops, and once again, my blocks are nicely sorted.
All right, I'm back at the computer. We're going to talk about the time and space complexity of this problem. The time complexity is big O of n, where n is the length of the array. And that's because each value in the array can be visited once by that mid pointer. And this is nice because the most efficient sorting algorithms typically have a time complexity of n times log of n. So what Dijkstra showed is that in certain cases, when arrays have repeating values, you can partition the array into, say, 3 parts, and actually improve the time complexity. And then our space complexity is big O of 1. We created 3 int pointers. When we actually code this, we're going to create an array for a swapping method. But when we do that, it's actually just going to be a reference to the original array. So we are not creating a new array. And we weren't allowed to do that anyway. The problem said we had to do this in place, and we therefore copying the array would have been against the rules. All right, so we have our algorithm, and there's only one thing left to do. You ready, Lucky? Let's code some Java. So I said there would be a helper method in order to swap elements in the array, so that's what I did here. This swapping method accepts 3 parameters, an integer array that I called r, and then 2 integers representing the 2 values that need to be swapped, a and b. And in order to swap those 2 values, I just had to create a 3rd temporary value. I set that temporary variable to the value at index A, just so I can remember that value because I'm about to overwrite it. So the next line says, take the value at B and overwrite the value at A. So now the value that was at B is in both spots, but I did save the value at A in the temp variable. So now I can use that temp variable and assign it to the value at index B. So this is a pretty standard way to swap 2 values. So if you haven't seen it before, maybe pause the video, take a look, and try to understand why this works. But anytime you want to swap the values of 2 different variables, this is usually how you're going to do it. Now you might be thinking, hold on, you're making changes to an array called R, but in the actual sort method, the array is called nums. Isn't that a different array? How are you actually making these changes? Well, let me show you. I'm going to open up IntelliJ here. Let's create an int variable A, and we'll just set it to equal to 0, and an int B, and set it equal to A. So because these values are primitives, when I created my variable B and set it equal to A, it did not copy a reference to A. It actually copied the value itself, which was 0. So these 2 variables are separate from each other. They each have their own copy of the number 0. And I can prove that if I take this B and say set it equal to 5,000. Now, if I print the variable A, B and A have their own separate copies of these values. Nothing should happen to the variable A because I did nothing to it. And when I run this, I just get 0. And that makes sense. I did nothing to A. I set it to 0 and then did nothing else to it. So when I print it, it should just be 0. Now let me show you something else. Instead of a primitive int, I'm going to use an int array. And I'm going to set it equal to, let's say, 0, 1, 2, 3, and then I will create another int array called B and set it equal to A. In Java, arrays are objects, and therefore they are immutable. I can change the internal structure of these. Whereas with the primitive values, each variable contained its own copy of the value. In this case, B and A are basically 2 names for the same exact list. And I can demonstrate this by changing something within the B array. Let's take B at index 0 and set it equal to 5,000. Now you can see in this code, I created an int array called A. I gave it some values, and then I did nothing else to the array labeled A. I did something to B, and then I did something to B. I did nothing to A. But look what happens when I print the A array. So I'm doing a raise to string of array A. This way I can see all of the values contained in the A array. When I run this, there is a 5,000 in the A array. And it's because when I set B equal to A, because arrays are objects, both of these arrays are pointing to the same reference, to the same place in memory. And so when I change one list, well, there is only one list. So I'm actually changing the list for both B and A. And that's why I can make changes within a separate method to that nums array and have it still take effect to the original array, because it really is just one array. So I'm probably not explaining that right. I'm not an expert. Maybe somebody in the comments can do a better job than me, but I hope you understand what I'm talking about. But now I'm on to the primary part of my code, which is the sorting method. And notice that this is a void method, so I'm not going to return anything. All I'm going to do is rearrange the array, and then I'll be finished. So I start off by creating my pointers. I set left equal to 0. I set mid equal to 0, because I put it in the same place as left. And I set right to nums.length minus 1. So if my array is length 8, then right ends up being 7. Next, I have a while loop. The while loop will continue to run as long as the mid pointer is less than or equal to the right pointer. So we saw what happened in the demonstration when the mid pointer went to the wrong side of the right pointer. When it became greater than the right pointer, our algorithm needs to stop. Now we will have our if statement. First part here says that if nums at index mid is equal to 0, or if it's red, we said we would swap the left pointer with the mid pointer, or rather the values at those two pointers. And that's what my helper method is for. It just makes the code much easier to read. So in the nums array, I swap left and mid, and then I increment left and increment mid. And if you remember from the demonstration, every time I had to swap left and mid, the mid pointer always ended up pointing to a 1, and so I always had to move it over. So I'm saving a step by just moving it over within this if block instead of waiting to read the 1. I can just move it immediately because I know it's going to be a 1. You don't have to do it this way. You could just move the left pointer on its own and then worry about moving mid in the next step when it finally reads the 1. However, if you do it that way, you're going to have to watch out for an edge case where if the first value in the array just happens to be a 0, you won't move the mid pointer. The mid pointer will just be stuck at the beginning of the array, and you'll have an infinite loop because it will never, ever become greater than the right pointer. So you would have to code for that one edge case. With this code, just moving the mid pointer right away, you don't have to code for any edge cases. So now let me show you the rest of the while loop. I've got an else if statement. This is going to tell us what to do if nums at index mid is equal to 2, or if I encounter blue. Whenever we saw the number 2, we would swap right and mid. And so there's my swap method. And then I would pull back the right pointer. So decrement the right pointer, right minus minus. And then finally, I have my else block. This is what I do when nums at mid is equal to 1, or when I encounter white. And in that case, all I do is increment mid. So mid plus plus. All right, so I've got my code here on the screen. If you want to take a look, you can pause now. You can see my primary sorting method up here, and then my helper method down here just for swapping two values. I've actually never submitted this on LeetCode. This is the first time I'm going to submit it. So let's see if my code actually works. All right, cool. Seems to work. I don't know about that runtime, but I'm seeing a bunch of greens, so I think we're okay. All right, so that's it for this video. Leave a comment if you can do it better. Subscribe to the channel for more LeetCode, and that's it. I'll see you next time.